Tonight's special guest is Don Reynolds. Don is a major figure in the history of New Zealand filmmaking. From Goodbye Pork Pie to Quiet Earth and River Queen, Don was there as a producer and sound man. Even today, his legacy lives on every night on our TV screens. If you are a fan of Shortland Street, you can thank Don for getting it all started. We welcome Don Reynolds as our special guest on The Beat Goes On. Don Reynolds, welcome to The Beat Goes On. Good to see you. Well, we're so honoured to have one of New Zealand's top sound persons and television film producers in our studio.
Really pleased to be here.
Wonderful. And you're visiting New Zealand. You live in Sydney now.
Yes, I live in Sydney.
You saw the light, you thought... New Zealand's not big enough for me, is that the
not at all. It's always circumstances, you know. I still love New Zealand. We come back here all the time, you know.
But you're just over here this weekend, and I thought, I've got to talk to Don. I have to talk to Don because he's so much part of our baby boomer history.
Yes, indeed.
And let's look at your baby boomer credentials. You're a classic. That marvellous year of 1947, you were born.
Yep.
And what was the date, Don?
The 18th of November.
18th of November, gosh. Now, where did all this happen in New Zealand, and what town, city?
Well, I was born in Taranaki, yeah. but we moved to the Waikato. So I was brought up on a dairy farm in the Waikato, the old 100-acre block, milking 100 cows. And
so what was the little community in the Waikato that you ended up in?
It's called Nahanapuri, and those people who drive from Auckland through to the mountains and go through the back route, through past Porongia, drive through Nahanapuri and past the school that the primary school that I went to.
Okay. So what did that give you? It's a wonderful country to grow up in. They say it's wonderful to bring up children.
But you know what's interesting? Working on a farm, I think film is so like farming in a sense that you've got the resources you've got. So when you're on a farm and you know something happens, you can't go down the shop and get another piece. So what you have to do is you have to make something from what you've got. So you might, it's commonly called the number eight wire and 4x4 mentality. And I think films are quite like that. You know, you're out there on location and something's happening and it's not quite what you wanted. So you have to adapt.
Well, how did a farm boy get interested in becoming a sound man and then a producer of movies? I mean, that's a step, isn't it? I mean, to do with agriculture, is it?
My mother had a theory that there's five boys in our family, and it was that none of us were allowed to just leave school and go back on the farm and then marry the girl next door and then we'd be stuck, you know. So her theory is she wouldn't let us, we had to leave and go and get a job, you know, outside of the farm. So I joined the Air Force out of the school and went down to Wigram in Christchurch at age 17. And a little bit of the story about getting in the film industry is that I was working in the tower in Whanganui and I had a girlfriend in Wellington. And I used to commute backwards and forwards because in those days, you know, that life wasn't life easy. I could, you know, there was an airline called Spans
that
used to fly in.
Yeah.
And, you know, this is all baby boomer stuff because only the baby boomer remembers this.
everybody else turned off because now we're right in the history of Spans.
So Spans used to fly backwards and forwards. And, you know, if you ever wanted to fly, I said, you've got a spare seat. And I'd just sit in the middle. The old DC-3, they used to have a seat. You'd sit in the middle between them or even the friendships had it. So anyway, I was down there in Wellington with my girlfriend and we were wandering around the streets and there was this film crew working, you know, and I thought, ooh, that looks interesting. Stood and watched for a while. Anyway, so flying back on the plane, back to Whanganui, they used to have a thing called the Public Service Gazette, which advertised every single job in the public service throughout New Zealand. And in those days, the film was run by the tourist department. And there in the Gazette was a job for a sound recordist at the film unit. National Film Unit.
And that's how it all started.
And so I applied, and I went down to Wellington for the interview, and the guy who was running the sound department in those days, a lovely man called Claude Wickstead, he said, oh, look, you look like you play rugby. And I said, yeah, as a matter of fact, I do. I'm quite good. And he said, oh, well, you know, the tourist department needs a lock. He said, oh, well, that's good. He said, you got the job.
That's all it took.
So you just transfer from one government department to another and suddenly I'm in the film industry, you know, like it was just...
It just didn't occur to us that little old New Zealand right at the end of the universe would ever have a film industry.
You know, we used to film the rugby in those days, you know, we'd film it on Saturdays on film and it would be out in the cinemas at 11 o'clock Monday morning, a 20-minute version, edited, wow. You know, processed over the weekend, you know, the commentary put on, all that, and then it would be in the cinemas at 11 o'clock.
There's a list of all the movies that you've worked on. It's just too enormous, but
yeah.
The one that stands out for me is Goodbye Pork Pie. Now, you worked on that as producer or sound man?
I was a sound recordist, but I also had quite a big post-production studio in those days, a sound post-production studio.
Now, that was the start, wasn't it, us New Zealanders making popular, mass appeal movies?
Around about that time. I mean, there was a couple of earlier ones, Solo and Sleeping Dogs.
Yeah,
and,
that's right.
But really,
it was starting.
It was starting. Yeah.
What do you remember about Goodbye Pork Pie?
Well, you know, it's interesting. If anybody ever says, you know, it was fantastic working on Goodbye Pork Pie, I know they didn't work on it.
probably agony.
And I was a sound recordist and boom operator, yeah. You know, on my own. Yeah. My wife was makeup and wardrobe. And so my vehicle was one of the police cars towing the makeup and wardrobe caravan. We would shoot all day on location. Like we actually drove from Kaitaia down to Invercargill, you know, yeah. and up the west coast as well of the South Island. And so we would shoot all day, and you know, in those days we had no radios, we had no cell phones, you know, and things were always pretty fraught. A very small crew.
Yeah.
And then you know we'd finish shooting, and when it got dark, but we still were 200 or 300 miles away from our next. Where our motel was, which was our next location. So then we had to drive all the way to the next location.
Did you think that you were making history?
When not really.
Did it ever occur to you that that you were such a pioneer, and or you just went about your daily job without even thinking about it?
Yeah. No, it wasn't quite like that, because I'd worked with Jeff quite a lot. Yeah. You know, I got to know Jeff when I was at the film unit, because he used to come in with, he was making a thing called Tank Busters, I think it was called then. I knew that Jeff was a really good talent. You know, I thought he had a real feel for making a film that appealed to the everyman. So when he came up with the pork pie idea, and he was trying to raise the money for it. I mean, I threw in all my services, the studio, and even my wife's services of makeup and so forth,
for part of the future income.
Because I sort of felt, you know, why not?
Yeah.
And that was a way to move forward, you know, because the interesting thing about being a sound recordist is that I was sitting on my little green school for years and watching how producers failed. You know? Yeah. And I actually realised that there was...
You were learning at the same time.
I was learning at the same time, you know. And anyway, the film was made, and I got 3 times my money back out of the New Zealand release alone, you know.
Wow.
So, you know, when you look at that, you've got to say, well, that was all right.
Yeah. Well, when you look at the film industry today...
Yeah.
I helped build this industry. I know Peter Jackson, of course, has created that empire in Wellington. But it must make you feel proud to think that top-notch blockbuster movies, not just little art house movies, but blockbuster movies are made in little old New Zealand. Well, great feeling, isn't it?
It is. And I mean, I think, you know, it's really attributed to the actual attitude of the people who work here, you know, that they for a long time were able to adapt and do whatever was required of them. And that's proved even, you know, with Peter and all his people there.
But just looking at the long list of accomplishments, being the producer of the very first episode of Shortland Street.
Well, it's a bit more than that. I mean, I was the chief executive of South Pacific Pictures when, you know...
That all started to happen.
Yeah, well, and what happened is that I kept looking at, you know, Neighbours and Home and Away that were running on television and Coronation Street. I said, why haven't we got our own? Yeah. So I started lobbying, you know, and you know, sort of got New Zealand Air on board, and then I worked out that it's really hard to make these things work. They fail more easily than they succeed, you know, and so... I bought in Grundy's, who were, in a way, the experts of making soaps, and Ian Bradley, who was then the head of drama at Grundy's, he came over and we sat down and we thought, what are we going to do? We need a soap, you know. So we sat down and we actually came up with the idea. Yeah, I don't know how many people know why it's called Shortland Street. But it was originally, we were going to make it in the old Shortland Street studio.
That's right, up the top.
And so we couldn't think of a name, so we said, well, let's just call it a working title, Shortland Street, for now.
And it just stuck.
And it just stuck, yeah.
So here you are, you're living in Sydney, you've been there since 1997, and yet every night in New Zealand there is a legacy of your work.
Exactly, exactly.
Wonderful.
If only I had a piece of it.
You couldn't have signed yourself up for 0.5%.
No, that would have been good, but you know, there were those days, you know, I was the company.
Look, we haven't got much time, but what are you doing today, Don? What's happening in the life of Don Reynolds in Sydney?
Oh, well, you know, I have... I've sort of pulled back on films a lot, you know, and I work with my wife and her company, and I do house renovations. And
completely out of the film business.
Completely, yeah. More or less. No, I mean, you know, I still have lots of conversations with people, but it's very difficult being a producer. That what people don't understand is that in order to be a producer, you have to be prepared to set aside about 3 years of no income and develop a project.
Yes, exactly.
And working through it and paying you need quite a lot of money to pay out to other people to get it going. And, you know, it's just in a way, I suppose, I've done my day.
Well, look, even today, 3-4 weeks ago, we had Craig Newlin, who was the producer of the Radio Hauraki story. So it never stops, does it? There's another Don Reynolds comes along and...
of course, yeah.
It starts producing.
For a long time, I had more credits on films than any other New Zealander, but I don't know if I can hold that anymore. So.
Was there the great... Film Escape, a movie that you wanted to make, but it didn't happen?
No, not really. No. I mean, you know, The Quiet Earth was one of our great...
It was a great movie.
It was another one of our great successes in a way, because, it, you know, it was a movie that was really hard to make and get finished, and yet it came out, and it's still one of the most successful films and what it grossed in the US, you know.
And I always used to wonder... After watching The Quiet Earth, they had many scenes where the streets were deserted.
Correct,
and I used to say to myself, now, what time of the morning would they have to film, or did you have to just wait until the street
were... Oh, no, not at all. No,
how did they do it?
We had to be out by, I think, 9 o'clock or 10 o'clock in the morning, but I have to tell you a funny story. So I'm sitting in Los Angeles in this huge theatre watching the movie with a big crowd, and when Bruno's coming down the Queen Street going, is there anybody out there? Yeah. There's somebody in the crowd goes, yeah, I was in Auckland on Sunday once too. So Sunday morning, you know, I think it was 9 or 10 o'clock we had to be.
On Sunday morning.
We had the streets with no traffic.
Yeah, I always wondered about the logistics of that one. You pulled it off.
Yeah. It all worked that one. Yeah.
So every time I see an empty street, I always say, oh, that'd be a great shot for The Quiet Earth. Yeah. Hey, Don. Fascinating to see you.
You too.
And you get to New Zealand about once every year or a couple
of
years?
No, two or three times a year.
Two or three times a year.
We did the rail trail in March this year.
Okay.
Down Otago, but the bike ride.
Once a Kiwi, always a Kiwi.
Absolutely. Go the All Blacks.
Thank you, Don.